Alright, welcome to the Daily Harmon. Today we will, we'll go over the rules of, general rules of civil procedure. And, just point out this, give you a little quick overview of how basically the system works. Okay, so basically what happens is if somebody breaks the law and then you get to go to court and make a civil case. And what you're basically doing is prosecuting for a crime, okay, without a prosecutor, without the regular government officials doing the work. You're gonna do the work. And you're gonna say, this guy broke the law, caused this damage, and I want fucking... No, I want the law imposed. So if the law has a penalty, I want him fined. And if I can get damages for what he did to me, I want damages and compensation for how he broke my life by violating the law. All right, so anyway, and so here's what it says about a claim. So claims for relief, as it says here, claims for relief. A pleading that states a claim for relief must contain. All right, a short, plain statement on the grounds of jurisdiction. So that's just basically, you know, you say, here's the law that he broke, okay? And you're the court that covers this kind of law. And so, of course, I did that. The DMCA explicitly says federal court. I filed in the federal court in Jones's hometown, which wasn't my explicit obligation, but it was my, I did that courtesy. Even though the law doesn't exactly say where you have to file, I gave him the benefit of the doubt and gave him the privilege of having the courthouse in his state rather than my state, because I thought it would be rather obnoxious to sue somebody 2,000 miles away and expect them, to manage a court case in another state. So anyway, but let's not go to, so there's no jurisdiction question. The court has jurisdiction. All right, number two, a short, plain statement of the claim showing that the pleader is entitled to relief. Short, plain statement. So that means, you know, the courts describe this. It's just supposed to be, you basically make your accusation. You say, that guy killed my mommy, or that guy stole my tricycle, or whatever the thing is, and you just say, he did it, and you can go into some sort of brief detail if you want, like, you know, he had an account on YouTube that enabled him to do it, that kind of thing. But that's it. Yeah, it's just basically an outline of the accusation. And you're not supposed to present evidence. You don't send with your complaint arguments for your case law. You don't send, like, here's the smoking gun, and here's his fingerprints, and here's a whole bunch of testimony of eyewitnesses. You don't put all that crap on your complaint. Okay? That just isn't, the court doesn't want it. It doesn't want to try the case. It just wants to start the case and initialize the case. And that's what you do with your complaint. And that's all it's supposed to be. All right, so now let's go to this catch. So that was Rule 8. So that's how the guy makes his case. And now we go into how the guy responds to a case. And so this is Rule 12. This is defenses and objections. All right, so you've got to understand that these clauses are written, you know, over time, and they change things over time. So this, you know, section was written when summary judgment didn't exist. Which means that, you know, they hadn't gotten this procedure where you can have a little mini trial where the guy accused gets to prove he's innocent. Okay, so it expedites things. You know what I'm saying? Like, say if somebody accused you of murder and you can prove you were in, like, France or something, and there's no way you could have committed the crime, you know, gives you a chance to just prove you're innocent, get the damn thing over with, and get the hell out of town. And so this was written before that. Before that existed. And so that's why this clause exists. So it's clause 6 here on section B. And it basically just says failure to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. All right. So the idea is that basically the only time this is ever used is when somebody makes a claim that's just outrageous, basically. That's the standard. I mean, I'll read you the different standards, but it's basically somebody just makes a claim that's just impossible. It just, and there's no evidence for it, really. So even if it's possible theoretically, like I could claim George Bush is a Martian, okay? I mean, I could claim it. I mean, it could be possible to somebody if they really bend every fact in the universe, kind of, they could maybe say, okay, it's possible he's a Martian. But it's not really plausible. It's not, there's no real way you can connect those dots and make that happen as a realistically, unless you have something. So you have to just say, you know, the court will say, well, that, you know, you have to give me more. You have to give me more. The court will say that to you. Give me more. And that's what the court has to do. So we'll move on a little further down here and just show that that's what the court has to do. So section E, a more definitive statement. So this is what basically Jones Orr asked for. He filed one of these motions for a more definitive statement, although he didn't quite, well, he stated close enough. It was recognizable. So a party may move for a more definitive statement of the pleadings to which a responsive pleading is allowed, but which is so vague or ambiguous that the party cannot reasonably prepare a response. Okay, let's be clear, though, that my complaint is quite clear. There's nothing vague or ambiguous. I cite the fact that he makes YouTube videos, that his YouTube videos contain the slander, and they contained my stolen content. Joneser admits in his papers that he has used my content. He admits in his papers that he has used, whatever he called it, name calling. All right, so you got he's basically admitted to, yes, I held the gun. Yes, my fingerprints are at the house. So I mean he's provided corroborating evidence rather than exonerating evidence. He's basically conceded to the circumstantial evidence of the crime, which is so ludicrous in this case. But anyway, all right, a motion must be made before filing responsive pleading. So basically you must make this motion before you do some other responsive pleading. And technically a motion for summary judgment is a responsive pleading. So this is where it goes all to hell. Because you can't do both. You can't say, I don't understand the claims, but here's my argument of the claims. I mean, that's just stupid, okay? And the court shouldn't allow it, and that's what he did, and it's just bullshit. I shouldn't be required to respond both to the accusation that you can't understand the case and that you understand the case, but you have a counter-argument. I mean, it's just bullshit. But anyway, okay, if the court orders a more definitive statement. So there you got it, right there. Can you read this, Melinda? If the court orders a more definitive statement... Okay, and the order is not obeyed within 14 days. Okay, see, you didn't order it. Okay, you have to order it. He can't just, he files a motion. I don't have to do anything. Courts tell us what we have to do. If Jones files a motion saying I have to climb a tree and whistle Dixie, I don't have to fucking do it until you tell me I have to fucking do it. All right, and that's your obligation. So you needed to approve his motion first. All right, it's just right there. If the court orders a more definitive statement, you had to approve this motion. And it's just bullshit. You did not approve it. So let's get it clear too. When was the dates of these motions? The motion Jones filed was for dismissal was 10/22/08. All right. So how many months ago was that? 16 months ago. It had terminated on 12/18. So it had already been terminated. Whatever terminated means, but it'd be terminated. You know. I responded to it on 12/05, and it was and it was terminated on the 18th. So whatever. I mean, this is such bullshit. And so this motion was never approved. I was never ordered to provide Jones R any further information. So I had no obligations here. And the major point I'll make is because there's no further information that should be included in a complaint. The only further thing I can provide you is gun evidence. I'll start providing you the evidence. I'll send you videos of him committing the crime. But that's all I can do. There's no other way I can describe the circumstance that's going to make it any more, that's going to add any value whatsoever. It's only going to be arguing the case, and you're not supposed to be arguing cases in complaints, and you damn well know it. All right, so anyway. So the court may strike the pleading for issue other than, okay, but anyway. So the point is that the court had an obligation to approve that motion. And then it's been traditional. I mean, it's just part of the law, which I'll read. That yes, I have to be given an opportunity. If the court's going to sit there and whine and complain that it doesn't understand copyright law, that doesn't, when somebody says somebody violated their copyright, they don't understand what that means, that somehow you need to be more definitive, even though you pointed out that they made YouTube videos that had your content in them, and even though the other guy's admitted to taking the content, somehow you need more definition, more something, that's not evidence, but somehow is more something. There's not any more something I can give you, except the image of my face in his video. This is one of my favorites. I think it was written by Marshall, whatever his name was. Following the simple guide of Rule 8, that all pleadings shall be so construed as to do substantial justice. Oh, that's not something I should have read, too. That was one of the clauses of the original Rule 8 before the Rule 12. The point is that the pleading, the claim is just supposed to be read as a general statement. This is the crime, and you're just, the court's obligation is just to say, yes, there's some reason to believe a possible crime is here, and that there's possibly a way that this person's entitled to something. Like, federal rules reject the approach that pleadings is a game of skill, in which one mishap by counsel may be decisive in the outcome, and accept the principle that the purpose of the pleading is to facilitate the proper decision on the merits. So yeah, it's your obligation, judge, to sit there and deal with the merits of this case, which have been put right before you. The question of what does fair use mean has been put right in your lap. That is the merits you are supposed to be dealing with. You're not supposed to be playing this bullshit game. So anyway, this is a statement that applies to lawyers' pleadings. The fact that I'm pro se doubles this statement, okay? I mean, this really isn't, I'm not supposed to sit here and engineer my complaint and put it all precise language. I'm supposed to just basically outline, he fucking raped my wife, or whatever the fuck I'm saying. Oh, this is just such bullshit. We developed two primary principles that guide our review of a claim so dismissed. First, we must accept as true all well-pleaded facts in the complaint. So in my complaint, I pleaded to the fact that he took my content, that he maliciously used it, that he slandered and libeled me in his behavior on YouTube, period, not complicated. And so the court has to accept those accusations as true, that those events did take place. Yeah, the end, my complaint's valid. And the complaint is to be liberally construed in favor of the plaintiff, so that I'm supposed to get liberal construing in my favor. You know, this is just slam dunk kind of crap. This is basic legal procedure. Second, a complaint should not be dismissed for failure to state a claim unless it appears beyond doubt that the plaintiff can prove no set of facts in support of his claim that would entitle him to relief. Well, under the DMCA, I am entitled to impose a $2,300 fine on somebody who violates my copyright. That's just a fact. Whether you're going to accept the fact that I'm entitled to any damages or not is irrelevant to the fact that in the law itself, a violation of my copyright can be assessed a per violation $2,300 fine. So this is just bullshit. There's just no doubt about it that they're standing for this case. Anyway, there's some really good stuff here I gotta find.